deep space salvage worker must join forces with the corporation that murdered his entire crew in order to stop a rogue AI that threatens all of human civilization. In Recoil, that's the book I'm reviewing on this episode of SFF180. Hello, everyone. Thomas here, your host again, as always. Thank you for joining me. If you have dedicated your life to being a fan of genre fiction, you lose, to some degree, the right to critique a specific work solely for being a kludge of secondhand ideas borrowed from other works. It isn't that originality in genre fiction is impossible, but as a general rule, SFF, like any genre, is an exercise in recycling familiar themes and tropes. Distinction and excellence lie in the execution. So while it isn't fair to pick on J.T. Nicklaus's Recoil for being essentially Altered Carbon meets Illuminae, it is fair to pick on it for being bland and unexciting. J.T. Nicklaus is a North Carolina writer, married to popular YA writer Julie Kagawa, with a fondness for neo-noir science fiction adventure. Recoil is a book that tries to pull together multiple influences into a cogent narrative. It starts as a noirish, post-human, space opera, detective story with characters trying to solve their own murders, and somehow by the end of it all, everyone is fighting zombies mind-controlled by a malicious AI in the darkened corridors of a derelict spacecraft. Now, while Nicklaus cannot for the most part be faulted on technical grounds, the end result isn't nearly as entertaining as it sounds. It's half past the future, and Carter Langston is a deep space salvage worker. On what he thinks is going to be a routine job, Langston cuts his way into a derelict, only to make the startling discovery of a dead man in the airlock. Whoever this guy was, he had locked himself in and disabled the door controls so that no one could get into the airlock from either inside or outside. That's definitely strange, but things get even more alarming when Langston breaches the interior to find the ship chock full of corpses, one of which, to his extreme horror, suddenly and impossibly attacks him. Langston barely fights his way free, and then someone, somewhere, remotely seizes control of the vessel, fires up the engines, and sends it on a one-way course into the sun. Okay, so far so good. When Langston awakens, he is in a new body, on board a space station orbiting Venus. This future, you see, is one in which, as in Richard Morgan's Altered Carbon, people have their consciousness stored in a core located near the brainstem. If your coil, i.e. your physical body, dies, you can either revert to a stored backup or have the data from your old core, assuming it wasn't destroyed, transferred to the core in your new coil. The recoiled Langston at first has no memory of what happened aboard the derelict, and he's alarmed to hear that the clinic had some serious difficulty with his stored backup, which was found to be nearly corrupted, even though the security for backups is supposed to be impregnable. Langston manages to contact Chan, a crewmate from his salvage team who has been recoiled into a male body, something she finds awkward and Langston finds disappointing. Clearly, something intensely criminal is going on, after all. Whoever was responsible for leaving a bunch of dead bodies on a spaceship and then murdering the salvage team that found them is now sending bad guys after them. These are the kind of bad guys who walk into public places like nightclubs and hotels and just start shooting guns all over the place, which I think would be counterproductive to keeping a low profile as criminal conspirators. Eventually, we learn what's what, and it involves corporate malfeasance so utterly evil that even the corporate malefactors think they've gone too far. Langston and Chan must team up with the very super assassin sent to kill them, a character who is so arch that even his parents must have known what his ultimate career path was going to be, because, I mean, why else would you name your child Corbin? With a K. Okay, so I'll start with some of the things I thought Nicklaus did right. The premise of storing your mind and implanting it into new bodies is a common enough one. Altered Carbon certainly didn't invent it. And this book might also remind readers of Murlafferty's Six Wakes. I was impressed by the way Nicklaus had thought through some of the social implications of the technology very well, while at the same time being puzzled by the ways he didn't. For instance, early in the book, I was curious as to why people in this future were bothering with organic bodies at all, when they could as easily be implanting into artificial bodies or even forsaking the physical world altogether to live in virtual upload civilizations. I mean, Charlie Strauss And Ken MacLeod have been writing stories about that for 20 years. We have to get halfway into the book, but Nicholas does eventually address this. It's all down to how even the most lifelike of androids never caught on, because they could never quite escape the uncanny valley, and how the cores themselves are partly organic, having to be grown inside each new coil. I liked all of that. I also believed how this technology had ended up perpetuating class divisions, with the wealthy able to access the most high-end, custom-designed coils money can buy, while the poor have to make do with whatever body and whatever gender is available to them, like it or not. The poorest of the poor might even be stuck in a disabled body. Because of this, many recoiled individuals experience serious body dysmorphia, with some able to adapt much better than others. But this brings us to the bizarre way in which gender comes into the picture. Now, Langston describes how he never had a problem on the one occasion he was recoiled into a female body, and how he even found its smaller size made working salvage easier, but I mean, I honestly couldn't figure out, in a future where the birth rate has fallen to nearly nothing, because recoiling has given everybody a chance at immortality, why are gendered coils the only choice at all? I mean, yeah, I can see there would be people who would want the experience of sex, duh, but I could also see how having a gender identity of any kind might become irrelevant to a significant portion of the population. And yet here we are in Nicholas's future, where strict adherence to binary gender assignment is a thing for some reason. And I just plain found it ridiculous to be told that recoiling technology had magically ended racism, particularly given that wealth inequality and class division has historically been linked to race. If anything, I can see a future in which the rich are able to grow perfect custom bodies, to be one that would not only be racist as hell, it might only avoid straight-up eugenics, only if there were severe legal consequences. Okay, so I know all of that might have sounded like nitpicking, but in a science fiction novel, especially one premised on technology that would have civilization-altering impact on the social fabric, you know, these little world-building details are everything. In addition to flawed world-building, Nicholas's writing favors detail in the tradition of hard SF. And this presents issues when it comes to action scenes. Now, the final chapters of the book detail an assault on a spacecraft overtaken by a rogue AI that has transformed its crew into mindless murder zombies. Most of us know where we've seen that one recently, but I will say that whatever its flaws, J. Kristoff and Amy Kaufman's YA bestseller Illuminae delivered its zombies in space action scenes with a breathless and truly cinematic level of intensity. Nicholas's action scenes, in contrast, feel as lifeless as the waves of anonymous mindless coils charging their way into our hero's bullets. In the end, Recoil proves that tried and true genre tropes need something more than to be given just any new body. They need a body with energy and passion and life. And there you have it. That's all I've got for this episode of SFF 180. Remember, the most important thing, these are reviews. You will not always agree with me, but if you enjoyed watching, please hit that like button, share the video far and wide with all of your SFF reading friends, and above all, please subscribe. If you have not done so, that is how the channel grows. You can also support the channel at my TeePublic store and at my Patreon, where recruits into Wink's army get little perks like getting to see some of my videos early access. I want to thank all of those people for their additional support, especially now during this very, very tough period for people when we're all having to scale back a little bit, due to the situation. I am really, really thankful for those of you who are staying on, finding it able to stay on. And I want to thank all the rest of you just for being the very best viewers in all of BookTube. And until I see you next time, happy reading.